So coming to question number 181, the following are long acting bronchodilators except, okay. So answer to 181 is option B. 181 option B. Okay, take new page. Okay, 181 answer is B, ipratropium bromide. Okay, so there are two types of bronchodilators. They are adrenergic receptors and adrenergic agonist and muscarinic antagonists. Okay, so see the airway, how the anatomy of the airway like this. This is the smaller airway. Here beta 2 receptors are found. This is a larger airway. Larger airway. Here muscarinic receptors are found. Muscarinic receptors. Muscarinic receptors are there. Okay. So muscarinic receptors blocker are ipratropium bromide, tiotropium bromide, tiotropium bromide. Here it is salmeterol, salmeterol, formoterol, salbutamol. Okay. So coming to question number 182. Holt-Oram syndrome is most commonly associated with which of the following congenital heart disease? I have told you number of times it is associated with ASD. Okay? Or it is autosomal dominant syndrome with ASD. Okay? Question number 183. Which of the following is the recommended IV dose of epinephrine for neonatal resuscitation? It is 0.1 to 0.3 ml per kg of 1 in 10,000 solution. Okay. It's a good question and there is an NALS update 2015 also. So let us discuss this question. Okay. So dose is dose of adrenaline is 0.1 ml per kg to 0.3 ml per kg 1 in 10,000 dilution. Okay, so if you will dose will be asked, sometimes they ask in mg per kg, so it will be 0.01 mg per kg, it will be 0.03 mg per kg. Concentration will remain same everywhere. Either you are giving by IV route, tracheal route, whatever you want, concentration will remain the same. 1 in 10,000 dilution. Okay. So let us discuss the topic NALS update 2015. NALS update 2015. Those of you who do not know, they should download the new algorithm of NALS. Okay. What is the changes were made? I will update you. Okay. American Association of Pediatrics revises NALS guideline. NALS stands for Neonatal Advanced Life Support. Every 5 years, they revise the criteria. Last revision was in 2015. Okay. So salient feature are 2015. The order of asking question. Order of asking questions. Asking questions where it is my mnemonic TTB, term, tone, breathing or crying, term, tone, breathing or crying. Okay, breathing or crying. You should ask the gynecologist 3 questions in this order. Either the baby is term, after birth, if you are seeing the baby, a good muscle tone, or baby is crying or not, breathing or crying or not. Okay, so this is the TTB you should remember, or whatever mnemonic you made. Second update is, no routine and don't eat. No routine tracheal suctioning. Suctioning in mass, okay, or any other condition. Routine ET suctioning has been stopped even for meconium aspirated baby. If you are seeing that meconium is present and is obstructing the airway, then you will only intubate the baby and endotracheal suctioning will be done. Third point is ECG for heart rate monitoring. Okay, this is the new introduction. Pulse oximetry for SpO2. Okay. SpO2. Fourth is resuscitation of baby. Resuscitation of baby should be done with, if it's a term baby, 21% oxygen. Preterm baby, it is 21 to 30% oxygen, and it should be titrated accordingly, oxygen concentration. Okay. Delayed cord clamping by 30 seconds to 1 minute. Okay. Another is, one box is added in the algorithm, first box. Okay, this box is for, okay, take the new page. First box is new in this algorithm. This box is for antenatal counseling equipment check. Okay, and team briefing. I will make the big box. In this box, there will be antenatal counseling, team briefing, and equipment check. Okay, so this has been modification. If you will see the NALS algorithm, there are 2 types of boxes. One is rectangle box for action, okay, and there is a diamond box for observation. Okay, chest compression is same, 60 per minute. And chest compression should be done by new modification. The modification number 7 is, chest compression should be done by, question, okay, take the new page. 7, chest compression should be done by 2 thumb technique. Not by 2-finger technique. Okay, 2-thumb technique is, you will encircle in the lower third of the sternum and you will compress the baby like this. If you will able to see my fingers, you have to approximate, encircle the chest in lower one third of the sternum, and you are compressed by your 2 fingers like this. Previously, we used to do cardiac compression by 2 fingers. This is 2-finger technique. This is now obsolete. AAP does not, NALS 2015 does not recommend this technique. Okay, so you encircle the baby in lower one third of the sternum and compress with your 2 thumbs, one third compression. Okay, so These are the NALS update 2015. So, coming to next question. Next question is cardiac looping is seen in, this is embryologic question and detail of this will be discussed in when we will read the development of heart. So, answer to this question is 22 to 24 days of gestation. Okay. Question number 185. A 7-year-old child presents with gross hematuria. He has a history of recurrent gross hematuria since the last 1 year. There is no history of pain in the abdomen or pyorrhea. A past history of URTI 4 days back could be elicited. Urine culture is sterile. Serum IgA and C3 is normal. Abdominal examination reveals no mass abdomen. The most likely diagnosis is. Okay. Hematuria is the feature of urinary tract infection, but it won't be painless. Okay. Maybe painless or painful, but most commonly painful hematuria may be there if the bladder cystitis is also associated. IgA nephropathy causes hematuria, Wilms tumor causes hematuria, and PSGN, option D, is also causes hematuria. But answer to this question is IgA nephropathy. Okay, and why I will discuss. Question number 185, answer is IgA nephropathy, that is B. So, hematuria. After URI, if there is a history of URI and hematuria occurs, hematuria after 1 to 3 days or after 1 to 3 week. Okay, this if after 1 to 3 days it is IgA nephropathy. If after 1 to 3 week, it is more likely post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. So, here URTI 4 days back, history of URTI 4 days back, so it is more likely IgA nephropathy, not PSGN. IgA nephropathy is sympharyngitic. Okay. Question number 186. Which of the following is the correct grade for VUR, which is associated with reflux of urine into the upper chalice system of the kidney, however, without any dilatation? I have already told you, grade 2, it is grade 2 VUR. Grade 1, there is a reflux in the lower chalice, lower ureter. Grade 2, upper ureter, but grade 1 and 2 has no dilatation. Grade 3 and 4 has dilatation. Okay, so answer has already been told. 186, answer is B, grade 2. Which of the following is the correct definition of nocturnal enuresis in children? Okay. Involuntary wadding at night after 3 years, involuntary wadding at night after 4 years, involuntary wadding at night after 5 years, involuntary wadding at night after 7 years. Answer is 187 C. Let us discuss this question. Question number 187, answer is C. Okay. So, see the milestone, baby becomes dry by day. Dry by day by 2 years. Dry by night by 3 years. Okay. But for nocturnal enuresis, cutoff is taken as 5 years. If after 5 years of age, baby still voids urine in the bed at night, this is called nocturnal enuresis. Okay. So, what is the treatment of nocturnal enuresis? What is the treatment modality? There is a bed and pad alarm system. Pad alarm system. There is a desmopressin by oral route, not by nasal. Okay, because nasal root causes hyponatremia. Okay. Other pharmacological therapy is oxybutynin. Okay. But best is bed and pad alarm system. Okay, NADAS criteria is often used to assess the presence of absence of heart disease in children. Which the following is one of the minor NADAS criteria? See the explanation, question number 188, here NADAS criteria is given. So what is the purpose of NADAS criteria? The purpose of NADAS criteria is to distinguish, diagnose congenital heart disease. So there are major criteria and minor criteria. In major criteria, systolic murmur grade 3 or more, diastolic murmur of any grade, cyanosis and congestive cardiac failure. In minor criteria, systolic murmur less than grade 3, abnormal second heart sound, very easy to remember. Abnormal second heart sound, abnormal ECG, abnormal chest X-ray, abnormal BP. Whatever you find in the cardiac examination is abnormal. So this is NADAS criteria. Presence of one major or two minor is sufficient for diagnosis. It is used for the diagnosis of congenital heart disease. At least you should remember this much. Okay. So, should see the explanation. The major and minor criteria, one major or two minor is sufficient. Okay. So, answer to 188 is D. Which of the following is of the minor NADAS criteria? Systolic murmur, not the minor. ECG, X-ray and blood pressure is minor criteria. Systolic murmur less than grade 3 is minor, more than grade 3 is major. So answer to this question is 188 is D. Now, coming to question number 189. Which of the brain malformation is most commonly associated with FACE syndrome? Okay, Arnold Chiari, Dandy Walker, cerebral atrophy, Blake's pouch cyst. This is Dandy Walker malformation. Okay, so what is FACE? So let us discuss this question. FACE is an acronym. FACE is an acronym, P-H-A-C-E-E. Okay, FACE is posterior fossa anomaly. Fossa anomaly, that is Dandy Walker malformation. I have already told you the detail of Dandy Walker malformation. Dandy Walker malformation. H is hemangioma. A is arterial anomaly. C is coarctation of aorta and other cardiac defect. And E is eye abnormality. Like glaucoma, retinal detachment, etc. Okay. So, coming to question number 190. Okay, which developmental abnormality of the brain is shown in the image below? What you are seeing in the CT picture is loss of sulci and gyri. So this is nothing but lysencephaly, a smooth brain. This is called lysencephaly. Answer to this question is 190B. So let us discuss this question. 190, answer is B. Okay. So, licensifeli, definition of licensifeli. Licensifeli is absence of sulci and gyri. Okay, this is licensifeli. Polymicrogyria is option number C. Polymicrogyria is not option D. It is increased sulci and gyri. Sulci and gyri increase. And Pachygyria is decreased sulci and gyri. Okay. So, this is not sulcus and gyrus. Now, option number A, Cygencephaly. Cygencephaly is cleft in the brain. It's Cygencephaly. Okay. Porencephaly is cyst in the brain. Maybe due to infarction, old infarct that converted after infarction, the cyst has been formed. So, porencephaly is cyst in the brain. Okay. There is another, these all are neuronal migration disorder. Neuronal migration disorder. Group is neuronal migration disorder. Okay. Another entity is holoprosencephaly. It is inability of the brain, inability of cerebral hemisphere to divide into two halves. Okay. So, this is 190 question number. Coming to question number 191. Which of the following statement about anencephaly is false? Okay. Defect of the calibrium meningeal skull. We have already discussed anencephaly. Rudimentary brain. Recurrence rate is very high. I have already told you. If one sibling is affected, it's 3.5%. Two siblings, around 9%. Okay. Recurrence rate is very high. And cerebellum usually absent. Yes. So, answer to this question 191 is C. We have already discussed. Question number 192. A 13-year-old child. Okay. First see the question. Okay, see this question 192. A 13-year-old child has multiple light brown colored spots on his body. A large single spot on his hand and is shown in the picture below. He has started developing soft nodular lesions. Multiple of them on the trunk, some of which are pedunculated. His physician referred the child to the ophthalmologist who diagnosed the presence of an melanocytic pigmented iris hematoma. Which disorder of this child seems to be having? So, this is the classical description of neurofibromatosis 1. I have told you all the features of NF1. This is melanocytic pigmented iris hematoma is nothing but a least nodule. Least nodule is iris hematoma only. So, this is the Caffelieu macules seen in NF1. Okay, this is the hallmark of NF1. So, I have already told you the diagnostic criteria of NF1. Okay, so Caffelieu macules, answer to this question is 192 is neurofibromatosis. Okay. Coming to question number 193, adenoma sebaceum presenting as firm, discrete, reddish, facial angiofibroma are often diagnostic of which disorder? Okay. This is also a tuberous sclerosis, is also a neurocutaneous syndrome. This is the description of tuberous sclerosis. Okay. So, let us discuss this question. Answer is A. This is tuberous sclerosis. Okay. Two genes are involved. Two genes, they are TSC1 on chromosome 16 and TSC2 on chromosome 9. Okay. These are the genes involved in two genes. Older name of this tuberous sclerosis is epiloia. This is called epilepsy, low intelligence, and adenoma sebaceum. Okay. Other feature of tuberous sclerosis is in CNS, there are cortical tubers, subependymal giant cell astrocytoma. And calcification of these tubers produces real or this candle dripping appearance on CT. Okay. In a skin there is adenoma sebaceum. Sagreen patch. Okay. Are there subungual or periungual fibroma is there. Okay. In CVS, there is rhabdomyoma in heart, renal, there is renal angiomyolipoma, and lung, it is lymphangioma. Okay, so these are the features of tuberous sclerosis. You should remember all these because these are frequently asked in the exam. Regarding neurofibromatosis, NF1, these are calm lesions, that is Caffelium macules. And there is one more entity called McCune-Albright syndrome. In this syndrome also there is calm lesions. But what is the difference between the two? This is called calm lesions of NF1 is called a smooth coast of marina. And this calm lesion is called rough coast of Mayne. Okay. So, for sake of remembering, NF1 is more famous. This is a smooth coast of California. And California is more famous. So, NF1 is more famous, California is more famous. So, calm lesions of neurofibroma, NF1 is a smooth coast of California. And McKinnor-White syndrome is not that much famous, so it is a rough coast of Mayne. The basic difference between these calm lesions is the calm lesions in NF1 has smooth margin, whereas this in McKinnor-White syndrome has variegated margins. Okay. Coming to question number 194, which of the following is the characteristic rash of measles in children? Oh, very good question. I have already told you the rash of measles appears on the fourth day. Okay, I have given you the mnemonic also. Very sick person must take double T. Okay, so it is maculopapular, starting from behind the ear and spreading downward. This is a typical description of rash of the new of the measles. Okay. Rash, option number B. Let us discuss this question. It's a good question. Actually, if you want to score rank in any exam, good rank, you should not miss this type of question. Well, these are very easy questions, you can score very easily. Okay. So, 194, answer is A. Option B is rashes referred to as due on a rose petal appearance. This is the description of rash of varicella. Dew drop on rose petal. This is the description of rash of varicella. This rash appears on day 1, remember. Rashes referred to slack tip, I have already told you, this is called Rhythma infectiosum, slapstick disease caused by parvovirus B19F. Okay. Another important point of varicella rash is appears on face, and involves trunk. This is called centripetal rash. And another feature is polymorphous. Different stage, rash in different stage is polymorphous rash. Okay, question number 195. Which strains, see. Which strains of HPV are most commonly associated with recurrent respiratory papillomatosis? It is type 6 and 11. Okay, type 6 and 11 also cause, let us discuss this question. Genital bards. Okay, 195, answer is D. Okay. Six and 11 causes genital warts also. HPV 16 and 18 causes cervical cancer. There are two vaccines against HPV. These vaccines are Gardasil and Cervarix. Gardasil is quadrivalent. You should remember the quadrivalent, that is 6, 11, 16, 18. And Cervarix is bivalent, 16 and 18 only. Okay. Question number 196. Minky kinky hair disease associated with. See the question. Minky kinky hair syndrome is associated with zinc, copper, manganese or chromium. It is associated with copper. Okay. The gene mutation in minky kinky hair disease is, it is X-linked recessive condition. So, answer to question number 196 is B. It is due to copper metabolism. So, it is Minkey-Kinkey hair disease. Minkey-Kinkey hair disease. As the name suggests, curly hair are seen. Curly hair. Okay. Gene mutation is ATP7A gene mutation. ATP7A gene mutation. Chromosome is, inheritance is X-linked recessive. Only males are affected. And children die in very early age. Okay. Cohen syndrome is, they have asked the inheritance, but it is autosomal recessive disorder. Question number 198 is, most common method of heat loss in newborn after birth is, answer is A. The question, answer given in the key is wrong. So you should take the answer as A, evaporation. Okay. So I will discuss this question. See this. Okay. I have not shown you the question. Minkey-Kinkey hair disease associated with copper deficiency. Okay, it is X-linked recessive, found one ill males, child die in very early age. Cohen syndrome is autosomal recessive disorder. And most common method of heat loss in newborn. Answer given in the key is wrong. It is evaporation. Perhaps answer given in the key is 198, it is C, not radiation, but evaporation. Okay. So, I will discuss this question. 198, answer is A. 198, answer is A. Okay. So, what are the modes of heat loss? Modes of heat loss. Okay. It is conduction through direct contact. Radiation without any contact, convection through airflow, and evaporation due to moist surface of newborn. So, for a newborn, this is the most important mechanism of heat loss. When a newborn is born, it was dipped in meconium or amniotic fluid. So, when the body is exposed to environment, the water on the body of the baby starts evaporating, and this causes heat loss, and this is the most important mode of heat loss in newborn baby. That's why for premature baby, less than 28 beaker or very, very low birth weight baby, when baby is born, we wrap in the plastic to prevent evaporative heat loss. Okay, so you should remember the most important mechanism is this. Coming to question number 199, which of these is not associated with differential cyanosis in a newborn? Okay, coarctation of aorta, TGA with PDA, PPH and interrupted aortic arch. Okay, answer to this question is 199 is B. I will discuss this question. Okay, 199, answer is B. Actually, TGA with PDA has reversed differential cyanosis. Upper limb is cyanosis and lower limb is not cyanosis. What happens in C? The coarctation of aorta, PPH and interrupted aortic arch. Okay, there is a cyanosis. Okay, in the upper limb. But C, the condition in TGA with PDA. This is the four-chambered heart, and this is, suppose this is lung, okay. So aorta arising from pulmonary artery arising from left ventricle. So blood comes from here to here, okay. And this is body, suppose this is body, and this is arises from, aorta arises from here. There is a PDA connection here to here, okay. And this body se phir blood in the right atrium, okay. Lung se blood in the left ventricle. See this pathway of circulation of blood. We will get to know why. So oxygenated blood is here. In this circulation there is oxygenated blood, okay. So oxygenated blood is moving in this, from deoxygenated blood in this loop. So what happens, from here to here this oxygenated blood comes, okay, and goes to the lower limb. Upper limb veins, upper limb is supplied from here through subclavian artery and all that. So lower limb receives oxygenated blood while upper limb it does not receive. You understood? Upper limb does not receive, this is upper limb, does not receive oxygenated blood. So there is cyanosis in the upper limb and lower limb will be normal. This is called reverse differential cyanosis, seen in reverse differential cyanosis, seen in TGA with PDA. Okay, so understood? So answer is B. Question number 200 sinister portal hypertension is prehepatic portal hypertension. Answer is A. C question. Sinister portal hypertension, answer is A. Prehepatic is also called sinister portal hypertension because it is associated with splenic vein thrombosis. Okay, so it is called sinister portal hypertension. Okay, so let us discuss this question in brief. Question number 200, answer is A. Okay, so portal hypertension, portal hypertension, portal pressure, pressure more than 10 to 12 mmHg. This is the standard definition taken from Nelson. Okay. So, portal hypertension is of three types. Prehepatic, hepatic, and posthepatic. So, prehepatic portal hypertension associated with splenic vein thrombosis. Splenic vein thrombosis is called sinister portal hypertension. Okay, hepatic, in prehepatic obstruction is above the level of sinusoids. In hepatic obstruction is at the level of sinusoids. Cirrhosis is the classical example. Okay, and posthepatic Budd-Chiari syndrome. Budd-Chiari syndrome is classical example of posthepatic portal hypertension. Okay, now it is finished. If you have any query or doubt, you can mail me at drneerajpgi@gmail.com. I am writing in capital letter, although this email ID is in small letter, drneerajpgi@gmail.com. I have tried to give you all the updates, recent updates, and see this video, your knowledge will be updated. Thank you.